and a very warm welcome to you. I'm Hayley Palmer. It's so good to have you here with me on the show this evening, especially as we are joined by Martyn Ware from Heaven 17, and we'll be catching up with him after this. To have you on the show. How are you?
I'm fine, thank you. How are you?
Yeah, really good, thank you. Obviously, we're just sort of coming out of lockdown, but what have you been up to in your world?
Oh, my world, my world. Well, I'm doing all sorts of sound installation stuff, and I'm writing, doing remixing for people. I've just done a remix for Doctors of Madness, who are good friends of mine, Richard Strange. And I'm writing a big rainforest installation at the moment. So, yeah, it's a lot of good fun. Also, I started a podcast called Electronically Yours with Martyn Ware. That's doing incredibly well at the moment. So I'm very happy with that.
Yes, love that. Well, we're going to go into my favourite song of yours, Temptation. How did that all come about?
Well, Temptation. I woke up one day and had an idea for a kind of constantly rising set of chords that sounded a bit like sexual excitement, and said, I was staying at Glenn's at the time, the lead singer of Heaven 17, and I said, you know, we could do this. How about if we use part of the Lord's Prayer? That's gonna be controversial, because I just heard controversy by Prince at the time, and he did the same thing, and I thought, that's super cool. You know, let's try that, because everybody knows the Lord's Prayer, and that's how it came about, really. And then we added the orchestra later, and yes, it became an epic, you know.
Yeah, it really did. And was it right that Virgin didn't actually want to put the song out?
They didn't originally, no, because they didn't have Carol Kenyon under contract.
Yeah.
So I was saying, and then they sent it off for a remix, and the remix was rubbish. And so we just got down on bended knee and said, look, just put it out, it'll sell. And they went, oh, all right then. And consequently, we all know what happened.
Yeah. And what did you make of the 1992 remix?
Oh, I loved it. It's actually a friend of mine who used to work at Virgin rang me up really excited. He'd just come back from Ibiza. And it was like, you know, it's not the summer of love, but it's one of the summers of love. And he said, Martin, there's a new version of Temptation out on a white label, and everybody's going crazy for it. If we release it, it'll get to number one. I'm going, don't be ridiculous. And it got to number four.
God.
So they actually bought the rights to it off Brothers in Rhythm, who were the remix team. And we love it. In fact, that's the version of the arrangement of the song that we do live, generally, on our live sets now, because we love it that much.
Yeah, well, I think this song really does stand the test of time, doesn't it? So we're going to check out the video. Number two in 1983. Enjoy.
I've never been closer. I tried to...
So rewinding right back, Martin, you grew up in Sheffield, and is it right you started in the computer industry?
I did. I worked on a giant computer that had 16K memory, believe it or not. Which is less than a pound shop watch, you know. But it was amazing. I loved it, actually. But it gave me time. I worked night shifts, and it gave me time to write stuff in the boring kind of periods while it was printing everybody's payslip or whatever he was doing. So that was a kind of good time for us, because we would I'd use all that downtime to be creative. Yeah.
Yeah.
This is before personal computers, you know.
And you were actually a founder member of the Human League. I mean, you left in 1980 to form Heaven 17, didn't you?
Yeah. Yeah, we kind of split up. It was the record company we were working behind our backs to split the band up, unfortunately, because they wanted two bands for the price of one, and it worked. You know, I mean, let's face it, Dare is an amazing album. I think Penthouse and Pavement is a very good album. And they got two very successful bands for the price of one out of that.
Yeah. And where did the name Heaven 17 actually come from?
I've always wondered this. Yeah. Clockwork Orange, the film. There's the bit where he walks into the record store and he's chatting up with two girls. And on the wall, there's the top 10. Obviously, imaginary songs from the future and bands. And one of them was The Heaven 17. And as soon as I saw that on Clockwork Orange, which is my favourite film anyway,
was it?
I thought, I really wish there was a band called Heaven 17. So it was all spelt out 17, so we shortened it to 1-7, because it's like more international and more modern. So I had it ready to go, basically, when the split happened. It was always an ambition to have a band called Heaven 17.
Wow, love that. Well, we're going to go into the next song, Come Live With Me. Now, what is this song about? Because it is a piece of fiction, isn't it?
It's definitely a piece of fiction.
Just checking.
I am not getting blamed for it being real. No, it was our attempt to write a classic kind of ballad, I suppose, based around those kind of, you know, slightly edgy French kind of love story films, where it's not quite all saccharine like it is in Hollywood. There's a bit of an edge to it. And, you know, obviously, I was 37, you were 17. Now it's quite controversial, but back then it really wasn't that controversial an idea. It was just to show that it was the entire theory of the song was the differences of ages, and like people going, well, you know, when I'm going to be 67, you'll be, you know, you know, I'll be dying a lot quicker than you. So it's kind of got like a bittersweet quality to it.
Yeah. Well, we're going to check out the video. Here it is, number 5 in 1983. Enjoy. Now, Martyn, we've got some questions from some of our lovely viewers. Mark would like to know, what is the first song that you ever purchased?
Oh, that's a good question. Crikey. I think it was a... I think it might have been Get It On by T-Rex.
Oh, like a single. Throwback.
Yeah. First album I ever bought was Alice Cooper's first album called Prettiest For You.
God.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's going back. I know I'm an old bugger, but...
I didn't want to say anything. And next question from Alice says, what was it like being on Top of the Pops? Are there any special memories? Now, this is my favourite subject to talk about because I want to bring back Top of the Pops. So good days.
I've been trying to persuade the BBC to bring back Top of the Pops for about 10 years, actually.
Really?
Yeah, seriously. I was talking to the head of music. I said, she said, we want to kind of be an event television music programme on the BBC. Have you got any ideas, Martyn? I said, Top of the Pops, perhaps?
Yeah.
That'd be good. Anyway, but they're not going to go there. Memories of Top of the Pops. We thought we'd made it, you know, because like you're a national star back in the day. If you got one appearance, that's it. You could say forever you were a bona fide pop star, right?
Yeah.
That's the truth of the matter. And of course, we were lucky enough to do loads. But you're just wandering around and there's like rocks of music in this dressing room and there's unfortunately people like Jimmy Savile on site as well. And you know, there was all sorts of strange and interesting things going on. But the vibe was very much, it was the programme to watch for the whole family every Thursday evening, wasn't it? And you know, if you got on Top of the Pops, you were made, basically.
Yeah, good days. I do miss a good Thursday night at 7 o'clock,
exactly.
Definitely. Well, we're going to go into the next song, Crush by the Wheels of Industry. Yeah. Simon, the exec producer on the show, loves this song. He said it's a song that inspired the 80s classic British sound, didn't it?
I suppose so. I mean, we were just getting on with what we were doing, but we were using a lot of the same technology that everybody was using at the time. We were also using really interesting sounds. I mean, the sound at the start, the kind of scraping sound of the industrial sound was us moving two paving slabs against each other in studio and recording it, for instance.
Wow.
And and then we got the magnificent John Wilson, who played bass and rhythm guitar on that track as well, who was only 17 at the time, believe it or not.
God.
And so we were really lucky. We hit the, you know, hit the charts just at the right time, I think.
Yeah, yeah. Well, it's a great song. We're going to check it out and we'll see you after this.
If and when you see the facts, they will lead us to the land of milk and honey. Work all day or work all night, it's all the same. If you want the pay, some drag tankers, some are bankers, some are workers, some are not. It is time for a party destination for the nation now. Some are workers, some are not. It is time for a party, liberation for the nation now. station or vacation. Some are workers, some are not. It is time for a party. Syncopation for the nation. Now, the wheels of industry. Press by the wheels of industry. Press by the wheels of industry. Press by the wheels. Press by the wheels of industry. Press by the wheels of industry. Press by the wheels of industry. Work! Now, hunt! Work!
Now, this is incredible. You worked as Tina Turner's producer.
Yeah.
What special memories do you have from those times, Martyn?
Well, you know, they just brought the new Tina documentary out and...
Yeah.
They cut me out. Anyway.
Oh.
Yeah. I bet it's not fair. I mean, but I am a character in the musical.
Yes, aren't you on Broadway?
Broadway, yeah.
Yeah,
man.
Well,
made
look
it.
At that.
My name in lights. Well, not quite, but you know what I mean. But no, Tina was just an amazing human being, frankly. And, you know, when I started working with her, she hadn't even got a record contract, you know.
Really?
Yeah, it's unbelievable, I know. And we did a cover version of Ball of Confusion by The Temptations for my BEF project. And then Roger Davis and her came back to me for the first, you know, the comeback album, and said, would you write some songs? And we, of course, me and Glenn, being stupid, said, we don't write songs for other people. That could have been my pension. But anyway, so we ended up doing Let's Stay Together by Al Green and 1984,
wow.
Bowie song. And Let's Stay Together was a big breakthrough hit. It was the best-selling 12-inch single in American history when it came out.
Absolutely incredible.
And so, why am I not in the documentary? It's not fair.
It's not, Martyn. We're going to have words with someone high up about this.
You have words, yeah.
I will.
They won't listen to me, but they'll listen to you.
Yeah. And I want to talk about Terence Trent D'Arby because, I mean, you kick-started his career. Number one in America with Wishing Well. Just brilliant.
Yeah, my lawyer rang me up in the Groucho and said, I think you're going to be rather happy with what's happened. Wishing Well is number one in America. And I was in the middle of watching a football match. It was in the World Cup. And I said, thanks. And put the phone down, carried on watching the football. I was so blasé in those days.
What?
I was,
how can keep I it just, together.
Well, I just thought it was going to last forever, you know, you just think success is going to last forever. Anyway, I was a bit blasé at that time, but it would deserve to go to number one. It's a great record.
Absolutely.
And I'm still very proud of that record. Funnily enough, I've just interviewed him for my podcast.
Have you?
For the first time in 25 years, we talked.
I need to listen to this.
Yeah, it's not out yet, but it will be out soon.
Oh, okay.
And,
keep us posted.
But I'm not allowed to call him Terence anymore. You've got to call him Sananda Maitreya.
Oh, right, okay.
Yeah, I had to edit out all references to calling him Terence.
No, right then. Yeah. Good to know.
Yeah, it is good to know.
We're going to go into the next song, The Foolish Thing to Do, featuring Jimmy Ruffin. Now, this is a superb song, isn't it?
Do you know what? It was an amazing piece of... pastiche, I suppose, of that kind of, I don't know what you call it, the kind of bittersweet songwriting techniques of, and like Philadelphia soul, and just wanted to do something that was pure class, using similar kind of songwriting techniques, but with a classic singer like Jimmy, right? So he's an amazing singer. Not with us any longer, unfortunately. But I was very proud of that song because it sounded so authentic that people thought it was an existing song that was a cover. So I think we did a really good job on it. And, I'm very proud of it.
Yeah. Oh, I love this one. Enjoy this and we'll see you after. Now, alongside Heaven 17, you've got your illustrious company business and you're also the principal of... Tiled Yard Education, aren't you? So there's a lot going on for you. Keeping you busy.
I'm always busy. I've got marking to do after this.
Oh, have you?
For my MA students, yeah. Oh. And but I love it, actually. I mean, it's a cliche, but I learn as much from them as they learn from me, probably.
Yeah.
But,
yeah.
You know, being in the music industry for 40 years is no joke. So I've picked up a lot of experience, which I can benefit them with. I do a lot of mentoring for young people as well. I'm also part of the Ivors Academy, which, you know, the Ivors Awards for songwriting. And
nice.
So we're always lobbying for artists' rights and stuff. So I try to put stuff back in. We've got a M17 gigs coming up.
I was going to say, when can we come to a gig? I mean, we're not certain, but what are the dates looking like?
Well, we've got some summer dates with Let's Rock in July.
Yeah.
But
I'm there.
I'm hoping it's going to happen. You know, I'm hoping.
Oh, I know.
And then we're touring in the autumn as well. And then we've got some more stuff in Germany and America the following year. And all those gigs we had lined up in 2020 have had to be shifted along. You know, so
God,
it's been tough. But you know, hope springs eternal. You know,
I think we're just all. You know, everyone's hoping to get back out to a festival, the performers and us watching, because we get such a high, and I think that's what we've all missed in lockdown.
I don't think anybody's ever going to take that stuff for granted ever again.
Oh, no, definitely not. Definitely not. Well, we're going to go into your next song, This Is Mine, a great track from 1984, and we will see you after this.
Yeah, well, I think we should wait a couple of weeks.
No, Martin.
I've told you, it's all right.
Well, we know the times of the delivery.
It's for weeks to come. Why do we have to do it tomorrow?
Look, the longer you leave it, the more nervous you are going to get.
Tell them this is mine. Tell them.
To the last song, Let Me Go, from 1982. Am I right in saying this is your favourite song, Martin?
It's mine and Glenn's. I think it's our best song we ever wrote, and it never even made the top 40. Interestingly, there's a Facebook group called Forgotten 80s, and they had a competition recently for 700 songs between, I think it was 80 and 84, that never made the top 40. Yeah, electronic songs. God. And we won it.
Against
700. Yeah. Worldwide.
That's an achievement. Yes. Yeah.
With Let Me Go.
With Let Me Go. Yeah. Wow. Well, we're going to play that out on the show now. And we're going to let you get on with your marking, because I know that's going to be a tough job for you.
I know. Headmaster.
Yes. But it's been such a pleasure to have you here on the show and really take a trip down memory lane. And we hope to come to one of your gigs and be there at Let's Rock. So we'll keep all our viewers posted.
Well, give me a shout and I'll get you on the guest list.
Hey, you heard him say that, everyone. Brilliant. Well, thank you so much. It's Martyn Ware, everyone.
Bye.
Oh, big thank you to Martyn Ware, just a brilliant guest on tonight's show. And here is that Heaven 17 song, Let Me Go.